Hi guys, I hope all of you are doing good. As already indicated, we are going to start module 2 today. It has 3 chapters. First chapter is about multi-carrier modulation. Second chapter deals with different multiple access techniques. And the third chapter deals with multi-antenna transmission and reception. The first chapter essentially deals with multi-carrier modulation, especially OFDM basics. Okay, let's start with the session. These are the contents which we are going to discuss. First one is multi-carrier modulation, OFDM basics, OFDM in LTE, timing and frequency, synchronization, peak to average ratio, and single carrier frequency division equalization. Okay, possibly in this video we are going to have only the first 4 components up to timing and frequency synchronization. In the next video we will discuss about peak to average ratio and SC FDE. Let us start with multi-carrier modulation. Now multi-carrier modulation is used in the many of the most successful modern wireless systems, including digital subscriber lines, that is your home broadband connections through telephone lines which you use, wireless LANs, already you are aware of that, digital video broadcasting, and beyond 3C cellular technologies such as WiMAX and LTE. Okay. Features are, it uses multiple parallel subcarriers which are generated by discrete Fourier transform, as well as the inverse discrete Fourier transform. Actually, we use the algorithms such as FFT and IFFT for generation and detection of these subcarriers. And the most common type of multi-carrier modulation techniques are orthogonal frequency division multiplexing, OFDM, that you are well aware of it already, discrete multi-tone modulation technique. Okay. And the purpose of having multi-carrier concept is to achieve high data rates. Second one is to mitigate inter-symbol interference in broadband channels. In order to have the channel that does not contain ISI, the symbol time has to be much larger than channel delay spread tau. That means the symbol time, one symbol may consist of many bits. Okay, that time interval should be larger than the delay spread, which we have studied in the module 1. Okay, and the second point is transmission bandwidth must be less than coherence bandwidth. Coherence bandwidth, you know that in channel, if the bandwidth which is free of ISI, that particular bandwidth is our coherence bandwidth. Okay, these are the two essentials which we want to have so as to avoid ISI. Now, what is this multi-carrier concept? It talks all about is an elegant approach to inter-symbol interference. It can be considered as an elegant approach to inter-symbol interference. Multi-carrier modulation divides the wideband incoming data stream into L narrowband subcarriers or sub-streams, you can say, and each of which is then transmitted over a different orthogonal frequency subcarrier. The number of substreams L is chosen to make the symbol time TS of each substream much greater than the delay spread of tau, the channel, or equivalently to make the substream bandwidth less than the channel coherence bandwidth. This ensures that the substreams will not experience significant ISI. That is, if we go through this diagram, we'll understand. Okay, see here, at input you have RBPS, that is the bit rate is R bits per second. Okay, this is a serial to parallel converter which divides this incoming bit streams of zeros and ones into L parallel bit streams. Now these L parallel bit streams, you can say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, like it depends on the number of subcarriers which you want to utilize and the channel bandwidth. Okay. and these bit streams are now converted to parallel bit streams, and individually they are multiplied by a carrier signal. You can see this is a carrier signal cos2πfct. Next one will be cos2πfc plus delta f. That is, this delta f is the bandwidth of subcarrier, we can say. And for example, we can consider fc as 500 kilohertz. Next one will be, if the bandwidth we consider for a subcarrier as 15 kilohertz, it will be 500 plus 15 kilohertz. Next one will be 500 plus 30 kilohertz. Next one will be 500 plus 45 kilohertz. Likewise, we can have different carrier frequencies multiplying the parallel sequences. These bit streams are then, the modulated bit streams are added, and the resultant signal x of t, this signal is transmitted over the channel. At the receiver end, what we have is, it should be a coherent reception. So we need to have similar kind of frequencies, that is cos2πfct plus delta f plus delta 2f, 3f, likewise, as I have explained. And then the individual signals are passed through low pass filters. After that, the parallel bit stream which we have obtained is converted to serial, and it can be considered as our received signals, which is r bits per second, and that is the one which we have transmitted, right? So in this way, multi-carrier modulation is going to take place. And what is the reason why we are going for multi-carrier modulation? As already indicated, to mitigate the inter-symbol interference, that is the fading we want to avoid. Okay, in this diagram we can see, if coherence bandwidth is this much, then beyond this bandwidth we can experience the fading. Okay, beyond this bandwidth, that is B is larger than BC, so this bandwidth can experience fading, but only a small number of carriers will be experiencing the fading, and thereby what we have is, we can say the flat fading occurs. As though the frequency selective fading occurs for the entire channel, but because we have divided the complete bandwidth into subcarriers, we are going to have a lesser number of subcarriers affected by this frequency selective fading, and the fading, we can now term it as a flat fading, or it is a very less fading. Okay, that is what we have achieved with this multi-carrier modulation, and thereby we have mitigated ISI. But the problem with this multi-carrier modulation technique just explained is, you can see over here, we need to have the oscillators, correct? This cos2πfct is generated through an oscillator, and then plus 15k, as we go on adding the subcarriers, we need to have more number of oscillators. That is, if we have a 1 megahertz signal bandwidth, then bandwidth divided by 15 kilohertz, we may get around 100 subcarriers, correct? Around 60 to 70 subcarriers. Likewise, if we have 20 megahertz, then we may get 1048 subcarriers. So those many oscillators we cannot have physically implemented, correct? At the transmitter as well at the receiver for generating different radio frequencies. That is the disadvantage of, or the drawback of, this technique. So in practical, we are not going to use this technique where we need to require number of oscillators working in parallel, correct?